Queen's visit drowned out the political debate this week, which may have suited the opposition. Public servants this week told Senate estimates hearings of problems with two of the opposition's boat people policies. The Secretary of the Immigration Department said the Nauru solution wouldn't work this time.
Combination of circumstances that existed at the end of 2001 could not be repeated with success.
And the Navy chief said turning back the boats was dangerous.
There have been fires lit, there have been attempts to storm the engine compartment.
Joining me this week is former New South Wales Labor Treasurer Michael Costa and former federal Liberal MP Ross Cameron. Ross, was this a case of the opposition under pressure from public servants disagreeing with their policies, or is that just public servants saying what their masters want?
Well, I don't think it's rocket science that turning back the boats is dangerous, but doing nothing is dangerous. I mean, the fact that you now have this flotilla of boats since this Labor policy was enacted is dangerous. I think the best estimates say that between 500 and 1,000 people have been lost at sea.
Where are the left on this?
Because, and this is the, I mean, we know how many boats arrive, we don't know how many boats leave Indonesia, and this is the great sadness. I mean, we've seen people killed in the Pink 100 house fires and people killed in Pink Bats. Obviously, we've lost Australian troops in Iraq and Afghanistan, but no policy has been so costly in human lives as Labor's asylum seeker policies.
So, Michael, is this a case of a dispute over how effective the opposition's policies would be? Luckily for the opposition, was drowned out by the Queen's arrival, or is this an argument that Labor could...
Look, I think it's over. I mean, the game changer on this was the cabinet leaks. You know, there was a point where I thought Tony Abbott could have been in trouble on the issue, but that those cabinet leaks, the way
these
they
are
were
the leaks where it said that
where they supported Nauru,
where a number of people in the immigration
it's
minister
over. This debate
Nauru.
Is over. Right. Labor has lost, and now it's a case of people trying to save face. I mean, strategic leaks from the New South Wales right, and I think they are from the right, to protect Chris Bowen, but also to distance themselves from the Prime Minister. Tony Abbott's won this issue.
Oh, so it wasn't, you don't think it was Kevin Rudd doing Kevin Rudd's leaking? You think it was Chris Bowen protecting himself?
I think it was allies of Chris Bowen and the New South Wales right trying to protect themselves in the face of potential leadership changes either towards the end of this year or early next year.
Ross, much of the media agreed that the opposition was under pressure over the last week over another issue as well, and that was Tony Abbott's warning to business not to buy future permits for emissions, carbon emissions, to hedge against losses after 2015 when carbon trading then comes in. With the Energy Supply Association said this created uncertainty, prices would rise, etc., etc. Is this a damaging accusation against Tony Abbott?
Oh, look, I think Tony's, you know, is an imperfect human being, but I don't find any substance in this particular criticism. I think if Abbott comes out and says, I'm opposed to the policy, and if I'm elected, I'll repeal it. There could be nothing more certain and simple than his policy on this issue.
Michael, I don't buy this argument either. I mean, I would have thought that if a businessman says, well, look, I'll bank on Tony Abbott winning, repealing, you don't need to buy future permits.
Tony Abbott's done the right thing. He's stated very clearly what his policy is. And if you're a strategic planner in any business out there that's involved in this area, you have to factor that in. In fact, he's done the right thing by making his policy very clear. And it's absolutely a nonsense because we've got a carbon price to come in first before we move to an emission trading scheme where the property rights start to become embedded.
Right, so when we see the media speculation about Tony Abbott having come under pressure this week on his various policies, you need to explain yourself better, Tony Abbott. I look at the two policies that they're arguing about, boats and the carbon dioxide tax. Tony Abbott would be happy to argue that from now to the election,
sure,
whenever it happens.
If that's the agenda, Tony's in front. And I think what we are seeing, and this is Australia's problem, that you've got a government almost like an aircraft that if it gets slow enough, it stalls. And that's what we've seen. We've seen a government that's stalled and it's now become entirely preoccupied with its own problems. If you don't know who's going to... And so there's no possible way that senior cabinet ministers can be focused on the real needs of their portfolio, especially making any kind of difficult decision when they know from week to week they've got no idea whether any decision in cabinet is going to stay confidential because everyone is jockeying for their position in the next phase of this government. Mm. So please, either let's have an election or let's remove Julia and put somebody else in there.
Michael, it seems to me then that Labor desperately needs a different agenda. I mean, stuck with these two Groundhog Day things. And so I was struck by Paul Keating this week. He's got a new book coming out called After Labor, and he got some coverage about one of his messages being that the Rudd and Gillard governments didn't have an overarching and compelling story. Big news. And that Labor has failed to represent the new economic class it helped to create. And I quote, Labor must be open to the influences of this middle class, to people on higher incomes, and I don't think it is. I would have thought that Labor is actually listening too much to the new class, but
no,
what do you think?
Once again, Paul Keating hits the nail, the political nail, right on the head. Labor has no story to tell those aspiring Australians, those people that want to get on with economic growth, build the their wealth for their families, what Labor's vision is. We're bogged down in a quagmire of policies that are really of no interest to the average middle class Australian. They are a function of the alliance with the Greens, and that alliance with the Greens is dictating the policy agenda for the Gillard government. What they've got to do is get back to the Hawke Keating model, which is economic reform, wealth creation, and a distribution of wealth in a sensible, targeted way, rather than this ham-fisted way that we're seeing it at the moment.
So you're making a distinction between, when I hear people talking about this new Labor class, I'm thinking about green-leaning, environmentalism, multiculturalism,
These are the people that want the McMansions, they want to have high standards of living, they like to have the two cars, they like their kids to go to good schools.
Mark Latham's constituency.
Mark's spoken about them, but this was the Hawke Keating core constituency. It was what the New South Wales right was based around, and it is the only place for Labor to be, supporting those people, moving away from the Greens. As long as we're mired in this quagmire of Green policies, we are in trouble.
Ross, John McTernan has just been appointed head of Julia Gillard's new media unit. Very savvy guy from Britain. What message would you think he should be telling Julia Gillard along these messages about what overarching message you should be pumping out?
Well, the only thing that will save Labor is a sustained period of good government. I mean, what we need to see, I mean, you build
possible
momentum
experience
on the basis of achievements, on the basis of taking difficult decisions, good decisions, sticking to them, implementing them effectively, and doing it again. And so even though, for example, you know, John Howard, he had his issues and he had his problems and he was never sort of Mr. Charismatic, but he picked his top three things, he said, this is what we're going to do, and he just went one after the other, bang, 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 and people knew where they were going. And that's what I'd be saying to this government. You've got to work out what is your agenda and then go ahead and execute it effectively.
But is Julia Gillard capable of that?
Well, look, I have the feeling that she is now, you know, she's like the injured sort of bleeding creature in the water now. And it's purely a question of who, you know, who gives the tap on the shoulder and when it happens, who the replacement is.
Now, you say, Michael, that you can't do that with the Greens there, but I think you can in the sense that where are the Greens going to go? I think Labor should simply stare them down.
I agree with that. I mean, the Greens would support Labor, I would have thought, on the floor of the Parliament. It's the formalised alliance. She needs to walk away from that, drop the issues that underpin that, and, you know, test if she has to in the Parliament. But whilst we're caught in that green straitjacket, her ability to govern for the majority of Australians, for middle Australia particularly, is diminished.
Now, we've got to go soon, but I just want to say, Tony Abbott, it's a bit hard for Tony Abbott to have small conversation. He's a big conversation guy, and I think that was illustrated when he met the Queen this week, and it was straight into real tough politics. Julia Gillard talked about the flower show when she met the Queen, but have a listen, this is Tony Abbott, he gets straight into the politics.
It's an interesting time to have
it. It's never dull. We play our politics tough in this country. We give no quarter.
Well, what would you have said in his position, Ross?
Oh, well, I think that's, you know, a pretty frank Here's Tony saying, let's talk about the reality of our situation, which is, you know, not a bad place to start.
He might have preferred that to talking about flower shows and
he
all that.
He might have too. And certainly, I mean, he is talking to an historical figure. I mean, we know most Australians sort of notionally would prefer a republic of some description, but there is no doubt this Queen will go down in history.
Yep, I think she would have enjoyed that one. Michael Costa, Ross Cameron, thank you so much for joining us.